We are going to put five mayors through their paces here on stage now. So the council officers mainly, obviously, and academics and other specialists have been doing their work, and it's time to see what the elected members have to say. Purely for the purposes of the most efficient possible advocacy, etc., the LGAQ has five groupings for council, five segments, and we have each of those segments represented today. So in the order in which they appear on my sheet and no other, a gentleman who I never actually thought of having a given name until I had to introduce him at our annual conference last year, and because he is known so universally as Marto that I actually paused because I thought, is Andrew actually his first name? I had never actually called him anything but Marto. He's Mayor Marto to everybody. He is one of our policy executive members as well. Would you please join me first up on stage, the Mayor of magnificent Blackall Tambo Regional Council, the Bard of the Barku. Marto, Mayor Marto. Thank you, mate. Welcome. From the Southeast Queensland Council of Mayors and just back from the United States, where they've been looking at Olympics and post-Olympic infrastructure, transport infrastructure, etc., really key thing for the sustainable games that the Minister was talking about, and I think you were talking about too, Al. From the beautiful scenic rim, and is there anyone here from Brisbane City? Great, because the very best view of Brisbane City is from scenic rim, and I'm not being in any way detrimental. No, seriously, scenic is so beautiful, and then when you see Brisbane and look across Brisbane to the bay, oh boy, it's a knockout view. So, and no wonder with such a handsome elected leader as well. Mayor Greg Christensen from Scenic Rim Regional Council. Come on, Greg. I've already mentioned him a couple of times today in dispatches. He's the Mayor of the Streets of San Francisco from Kershire. Mayor Michael Douglas, please welcome Mayor Michael Kerr. I'm so happy there are people here old enough to remember the streets of San Francisco as well. Another one of our policy executive members, and Michael is from the Coastal Councils, and Greg from SEQCOM as well, representing the Resources Councils, but also, of course, sitting very, very much at the centre of the rural and remote councils where Marto is. Would you please welcome the Mayor of Isaacshire, the magnificent Anne Baker. Anne, welcome. She's just coming to hug me on the way past, and don't you worry about that. And back to the stage from our First Nations councils, would you please welcome Mayor Ross Andrews from Yarraba Aboriginal Shire Council. Actually, I'll take those two, if that's okay. We'll have five up here and then we'll release two into the wild for questions and answers, shall we?
We're
turning the screen off.
Well,
it's a lie. It's
not
the shine.
Yes. Oh, it's not the shine. Look, I don't want the spotlight on you.
No, I see. Look, was that a setup?
All right. I'll turn the light on my phone and we'll catch them that way. But listen, thanks everybody. Thanks, A, for making time to be here today. It's really vital, and it says a lot about the importance of this issue and about the importance of the QCRC program that you and other elected members and mayors are here. So thank you very much, and thanks for agreeing to do this here today. So we'll just go segment by segment, and of course it is individual council by individual council as well. We'll start with you, Marto, and we'll hear about rural and remote councils first of all. We've got Mayor Dillon here, of course, from the magnificent Buck Holden. But how are you addressing climate risk, but also climate opportunity at Blackall Tambo?
Well, I guess there's a lot of similarities around the room. It's social and it's economic. We do have a little different perspective in our area. Mayor Dillon's in the same, in the Rapid area is about 30% of the geography of Queensland and involves seven remote shires. We're agricultural producers, by and large, and we're well aware of the climate risk. My family's been in the Tambo district for 140 years, which doesn't say much for our intellect, but it says a fair bit for our resilience. So, apart from myself, we're finding lots of freshwater fossils from millions of years ago, which means, obviously, that there was something different way back. We're well aware of climate change. We were an inland sea for millions of years, four times, in fact. And it was freshwater inland sea, and freshwater comes from up there, okay? I've found Huon pine fossils on my property, 18 foot deep. At least that's what the Queensland Museum have told me. So we're well aware of climate change. We're well aware that the only thing that's constant about the climate is change. I'm not going to get into the era of the delicacies of who and what and why, but we're aware of it, and we've got to be aware of the risks of not taking preventative measures. We would much rather be prepared for a drought than have to fight the bloody thing when we're in it. Okay, and that requires economic policy in concert with state and federal governments, incentives and whatnot. Diversity of income is another important economic imperative. Tourism's been awfully good to us, and we're building on that. That's an alternative source of income and a constant, and becoming more and more profitable. It requires product development, it requires infrastructure development, it requires a lot of things. And we're in a remote area. Don't ever forget that we're a remote area, 1,000 kilometres that way. The other thing is innovation. We're always innovating. More latterly, we've been encouraged by the rhetoric, at least from everywhere, that we've got to develop industries out in the regions, and we're not regional, we're remote, but we're taking them at their word. And there's a lot of, Mayor Dillon's got the Barcaldine Renewable Energy Project just up the road from me, an enormously visionary thing that which will create enormous labour. And we've got in our shire, it's not mine, it's ours, we've got a proposal for a woolen mill. It's not a little, you know, spinning wheel in the corner thing. It's a $200 million project. It'll double the population of our shire. It will double the population. Double the population here and you've got trouble. Double the population of my shire and we've got success. We've got some inherent issues about that. But so innovation, adaptability, all those things without taking up too much time.
So just in terms of drought and drought management, particularly for someone like you who comes from a long history in the primary industry, when they say that we hear about the heat issues and the heat management issues, I think about you and your flock, and I don't mean your community, I mean your actual livestock sheep, but also keeping the community, or keeping the locality an attractive community for people to come and live there. Are there some risks inherent in not getting ahead of that as well and not planning for that as well?
Absolutely. We're aware of the heat risk thing. Most of us, for years, when the moon's up, we work. The sheep are quite used to it. They're wearing wool, which is the greatest natural fibre on the planet. It keeps them cool in summer and warm in winter. So buy wool, guys, buy wool. We're aware of those, the livability issues. We need, in concert with encouraging tourism and other industries, we need to be aware of those, you know, the heat risk. You know, it was 47 the other day, but it's been 47 a million times in my lifetime, and we're used to it. And we're only mad dogs and Englishmen. I'm not, I'm an Aussie. Go out in the midday sun. We work around it. People, you've got to take a logical, practical approach to these things.
Greg, what about for Scenic Rim, which of course is one of the most important and most intensive food bowl local government areas in the state? Where is your council, do you think, in terms of managing, adapting, ameliorating climate risk?
I think we're in a pretty good place, much better than we were 6 years ago. But we share, I'm not going to go through, we share a lot more in common.
Thanks, Sam. Thanks, Bob.
They were trying to gag me. We share a lot more in common with a lot of the other people at this table, we're a region that less than 3% of our region is intended to be urbanised through to 2050 at least. What we carry is environmental precincts and agricultural precincts and the headwaters of the critical waters that determine the quality of life in Moreton Bay. Nothing important. We've experienced, I'm getting a few miles on the clock, we've experienced the direct impacts of, you know, I'm watching climate change, I'm watching the Great Dividing Range change shape in the last 10 years. I've watched it as landslips have reshaped the top of the range. I've watched as the Leamington National Park collapsed in 2017. That's not from man's intervention, that's climate change in action. So there's a bigger conversation there. But as a region, we've got a climate change statement of intent with a focus of unification, and we don't talk about, we talk about the opportunity. So for example, our farmers have come to us after the floods last year saying, we can't keep going the way we're going, watching our nutrient flush away each time it floods. So now we're talking about regenerative agriculture, which actually locks the carbon in the soil, so you're now in the carbon market, and it improves the productivity of your land permanently and transforms the quality of your produce to be giving health outcomes. Now that's as a response to the community saying, we need help. So rather than us going out and trying to start the conversation about climate change, we've all got to get on board to move forward. We've got parts of the community who are really on that journey, which is great. But we're taking everyone on the journey from where they are to move forward and deliver something, because we don't have the capacity to fund it. Honestly, the state's not going to fund it. The feds aren't going to fund it. This will take the honest effort from people realising this is my next generation's opportunity. I need to act today. That's the inherent motivation. And it takes a lot of conversation one by one at the farm gate, at the headland, at the fire shed. That's the place this happens. So we're focused on mitigation. We're focused on adaptation. But we have this massive opportunity of regeneration. And that's something that a lot of the urban councils don't have a chance to do. But I got one of the great fights that I'm glad I won in the SEQ regional plan was fighting to keep a larger lot size, a larger minimum lot size for my community. And I'll fight again in this one, because we at least have the chance to mitigate the urban heat signature by having blocks that are big enough for people to actually have a balance of shade to create the cooling effect as part of their natural environment, not to try to force it back in place. And my mantra at the time was, we're the one place in southeast Queensland you'll still be able to play backyard cricket.
Well, the Australian selectors might be happy for that for other reasons down the track. We've heard a good story already today, Michael, from FNQ. But what about in Douglas Shire specifically? What do you see as risks and opportunities for your council, for Douglas?
Yeah, thanks, Tim. I mean, when you're the caretaker of an area of land that sits between two World Heritage areas, it's a given that you have to be upfront with this. And, you know, when you've got beaches like we've got at 4 Mile Beach in Port Douglas, Cape Tribulation, you know, you've got to make sure that you retain them for the long haul. So we passed, back in 2019, we did our Resilient Coast Strategic Plan. And last year we took on our foreshore management plans, which is a full strategic plan of each different beach, and it gives a full overview of what the landscape is of each one. It gives what the hazards are, what adaptations are required, how to go about putting them through. It's a full document suite of what we can do, and through that we've managed, you know, updated all our stormside and erosion maps so that we've got that future planning there. The foreshore revegetation projects and dune projects, that's been a big one where we can actually improve the beach accesses where we want people to go, and we can do things to stop them from going into areas we don't want them to go, to improve those beaches, to decrease the erosion areas there. One fun one we did was the coast snap photo points, which you may have seen those are little brackets that are on the beaches where anyone can come along, put their iPhone or their phone in, take a photo and send it to the QR code. So there's a stream of erosion photos that show exactly what's happening on those beaches there. We've been a member of the Reef Guardian program, and each year we attempt to deliver five different actions from that program, which, you know, reduces the land-based impacts towards the reef. And we're also been ecotourism certified for many years, so we were one of the first destinations to get that accreditation. We're currently going through a process of investing in renewable energies. We're looking now at the buildings that we've got and which ones don't have solar on them and what we can do toward that. Unfortunately, we can't go down the road of electric vehicles because when you're in a shire that probably two-thirds of it doesn't have power, that doesn't work. So we're looking at hybrid vehicles at the moment, which we're changing over to with council. We've been a strong supporter of the Mossman Mill, our local sugar mill, which went through a very bad financial time. They've put forward a lot of goals to become a bioprecinct, and they're doing extremely well at that. And they will be eventually a complete circular economy, making a completely different product out of the sugarcane, which they can harvest 365 days a year. So it takes away that threat that we currently have of just having that short period. And a big one that we're doing is supporting the federal government to put through the microgrid through the Daintree. Now, currently, the Daintree burns 4 million litres of diesel a year. Now, this is supposed to be one of the greenest zones in this country and this state, and yet we're allowing this to continue, them burning 4 million litres of diesel a year to power themselves. Now, it's taken the federal government to come forward, committing $20 million to it. They've now got private entities into it, so hopefully April they're going to start digging trenches if everything goes to plan. You know, it's a necessity. We have to get that out of the Daintree. You know, you can't be a true green eco-destination whilst you're allowing this to happen.
And obviously tourism is a very important component of your, in fact it's a very important component of everyone's economy here. Yeah. But do all tourists arrive in beautiful Douglas Shire expecting it to be a leader in terms of how it's managing its climate its output, its climate risk, etc., etc.? Yep. They come with a preconceived idea of what it will be like.
Absolutely, and it was really good. I went to the TTNQ forum the other day about sustainable tourism, and one thing they've now come to alignment is that it's a waste of time advertising that you're just a carbon neutral destination. People want to see the reality of what the actual things are that are coming from being a carbon neutral, you know, and they're the selling points. That's what people actually want to see. Ecotourists, you can't crap to a crapper. You know, they know, you know, what ecotourism is, right? So telling them you're an ecotourism destination, they arrive there, you're giving them a false promise if you're not. You know, so you've really got to be walking the walk if you want to be an eco destination.
Yeah, thank you very much for that. So off to resources now, and Mayor Ann Baker. Ann, what in your view is your council doing to address climate risk, but also to maximise some of the opportunities coming in for Isaac?
The first thing, is that working?
I don't know.
Doesn't sound like it's working.
Is it honestly one of these working?
This one is, yeah. Thanks, Tim. I think the first thing for me, just to say that, you know, we're the largest met coal region in the country, so we've got a lot of challenges, obviously, just with the natural rhetoric that gets tossed around every day in the headlines of the paper. So what we're practically doing and have been doing for some years, the last few years in particular, is absolutely leaning in to the climate discussion. And it's been a long time where areas like ours have been talked about, talked at, but not talked with. So I really welcome the opportunity for forums like this, and there's several others, and it's a really good thing, because everyone's got a priority around the climate and around our environment and around the livability of our regions and our communities. It's important to all of us. So that's just a bit of a snapshot. But as far as our region goes, we are a resource region. 30% is thermal coal, which leads into the energy discussion, but 70% of our region is met coal, which makes coal, makes steel, delivers steel, and at the moment there's no equitable answer to that. But not only that, in the Isaac region, we've got agriculture, very diverse landscape. We cover off on tourism and we're escalating that. And we absolutely have a significant investment in renewables. So all of the above are happening as we speak and have been happening, quite frankly, for a long time. So it's part of the engine that drives the whole sustainability of the 17 unique communities in our area. I think what we are really focusing on at the moment is the social resilience piece. And it's talked about, social resilience is talked about a lot, especially in the climate change, you know, with the climate change debate. But there's really, we're not really seeing a real lot of consensus about what does that actually mean. So I have to say personally, I've been really encouraged today that nearly every speaker at the podium has not just talked about climate change and you know, climate change technically and what needs to happen and is it true or isn't it true? Of course, you have to back the science. But to hear people consistently talk about the social element is just... I can't wait to get back to region because I've said to the staff that are here with me, like, I feel as though for well over a decade that we're starting to be heard around the social piece. You know, we're on the same lane, working towards policy framework, talking to state government, talking to federal government, and you know, to be clear about our patch, there's 75% of our jobs in our region will be impacted, no doubt, around just the decarbonisation agenda. So, you know, there's opportunities that will come with that. And that we're leaning into the next economy. It's a clear priority of our council to lean in to understand what that practically means. We're working towards a great project called the Isaac Resource Excellence Hub. We were successful with $2 million from the federal government in the election to give us some work towards scoping and the concept of that. And that's going to look towards not only the future jobs and future opportunities through different diverse sectors, but also the people that are currently employed. With 75% of a region that's the same size as Tasmania, your people being impacted by just the decarbonisation, you know, there's a problem, Sherlock, if we're not thinking about the future and what does that look like, what's the framework, where's the regulation, what group is overseeing the transformation of all of this? It can't just be left out to just happen in isolation. No one local council or local group or local entity is going to be successful here. We have to all be in the tent together.
What do you think your community expects of council, particularly in light of the fact that the state government's pulling some very big levers that will have a very profound effect on employment in your community?
Mm.
The federal government also some levers, but I think it's really the state that's pulling the levers that will have the most profound effects for now. So what's the community expect of council? How does it expect council to lead in this circumstance?
Oh, I feel as though community look to us to represent, but community, you know, it's already been said today, this is a difficult conversation. It's a difficult conversation to have with your internal staff, with your own council in some instances, not in mine, but in some instances, let alone with your broader community. So I really support the thinking and around get it right internally. Know your stuff before you go broader out, but our community always looks to us to represent, stand up and present. So, and whether that's a difficult conversation to have or not, we lead with, it's hard. No one's saying it's not easy. It's not but a lot of the hard things we do are the most worthwhile. So walk through the door, have the hard conversation, and if we meet halfway in the middle, we'll have success. So
at least we're having the conversation. I think one of the things that surprises people about Isaac is it actually has quite a bit of coastline and beachfront. Not as much as Yarrabah.
And it was remiss of me not to mention that we do have 100 kilometres between Mackay and Rockhampton of beautiful coastline, and we worked really hard with our communities on the coast around the adaptation strategy. In fact, won an award for the consultation that we went above and beyond, way past the recommendations that were put to us, to ensure that our community, we were walking beside our community, not talking at them or to them, but with working with them.
Now, what normally happens when you have five mayors on stage is one of them is very quickly saying, we have the best beaches in the Of course, Anne is surrounded.
I'm not in competition with Whitsunday or Cairns.
The Mayor of Douglas, but also, as we saw in the microgrid presentation, Ross, the beautiful beautiful beachfront and coastline there in Yarrabah. I'll let you sing its praises in a moment. But tell me, first of all, about climate and your community and what risks and opportunities there might be for the Yarrabah community.
I think the issue of climate change and global warming is universal, and for us First Nations community, it's also a challenge with our fellow local governments, and for us at Yarrabah at the local scale. I know we've been working pretty hard now for the last couple of years in terms of I think last year we finished our coastal adaptation strategy. And the implementation of that and working as a council, but working also with the community. We also have a partnership with the Wet Tropics Management Authority. Many of our local councils also have, if there's a native title determination, prescribed body corporates, and prescribed body corporates do care for country, as they've been caring for the country for the last 65,000 years. But over the last 200 years meant that we've had to adjust our thinking and embracing many of the challenges around global warming and climate change. I just want to acknowledge also that the people in the Torres Straits are challenged daily in terms of the high watermark there and their living conditions. And I think someone mentioned about a social, human and economic impact that all of us have. And, you know, I think also with many of the developments and programs that are run throughout the state and country that also impact our wildlife and many of our wildlife, fauna and flora. We also have a spiritual connection with them, with the our totems as well. So not only is it human, social, but economical, it also has an influence on fauna and flora. The transfer station with the FNQ Rock is where we're taking most of our waste and landfill up to Mareeba Shire. So we're working with FNQ Rock about transferring our waste. The PBC, the prescribed body corporates, do a lot of work with the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park Authority, Tangaranga Blue, which goes out to collect marine debris, clean up our beaches and takes tons of waste away from the reef and away from our coastline as well. But many of the First Nations rangers also do fire hazard burning. So we've got about 7,000 hectares of wet tropics area, very pristine, very untapped. So we really work closely with the prescribed body corporates about protecting those areas around the wet tropics area, because you know, it's really, really a gem. You know, similar to the Daintree, we have all this area that's not haven't been used. Yeah, no, it's just a partnership with industry and with you know, governments about how can we best support this getting beyond and caring for country and looking after country, because I know the old people used to say, you'll have to, you look after country, you'll look after you.
Before we go to questions from the floor, and I'm hoping you will have a few questions in about 10 minutes' time. Ross, while you've got the mic there, and I'm going to ask each of you as well what you think the QCRC program might focus on, should funding be, further funding be made available by the good friends of the beautiful state government. I get a bit choked up when I just start to describe them. They're wonderful, wonderful people. But because the program is delivering, there's no doubt about that. But I'll ask you in a moment about what you think the QCRC program could focus on in the future. But first of all, Ross, if I could just pull something out of a box here on stage to best support your council as it tries to manage climate, and climate risk, and climate opportunity, is there one thing do you think that might really help?
Money would help.
Okay. I reckon you might be the first. I don't think you'll be the last to say.
Yeah, I was very enlightened by what the minister had to say this morning around the First Nations climate plan or strategy, maybe to complement existing work that are out there by other sectors. But you know, as I talked about this morning, there's a lot of plans being shelled and collected dust. The hard part is implementing and advocating, getting the investment and resource to support those plans. And when you look at those planning documents, you know, those planning documents also come from community. And if we are to take the community on the journey of whether it's climate change or global warming or any other challenges that are out there, we have to get some backing on them, you know, whether it's government, private or corporate sector. I think that's important.
And if there were this, I've got this box down here, and there is some money in it. It's contingent. All money is contingent on something, isn't it? But is there something that you think would help your council or councils generally as they you know, do this vital piece of work?
Yeah, look, I'm definitely not going to talk about not more funding. I absolutely support the fact that the program needs to be expanded and I would say increased funding, so not just a repeat of what. But money isn't a big element, but it's not the only element. What the money and the funding funds infrastructure and will help us with programs and projects and all of that. But we need that to connect and align with the ground service delivery and the social, like, it's all got to connect. So definitely the funding, we can't do anything without it, but there has to be a direct alignment with that funding, you know, not just bricks and mortar. It is the social piece that needs to be connected in there, and it's, I think that's really important, because yeah, I think that's,
Michael, as far as you're concerned, what would be useful coming out of this box?
Again, the funding streams, but with the funding streams, you need the ministerial support. So you've got ministers that are making decisions on funding who have never stepped foot in the Shire. You know, like, you've got, I mean, for me personally, I can say the environment minister has never stepped foot in my Shire. The energy minister has never stepped foot in my Shire. The housing minister has never stepped foot in my Shire. You know, we're in an area where, you know, we need the support. They need to know what's happening in these areas if they're making these decisions around the funding streams. You know, for areas like us, rubbish, rubbish, rubbish. You know, we are stuck with rubbish. We have to transport it everywhere. We need funding streams to deal with the landfills that we've got. You know, so they need to be aware of the actual regions as well as sitting here making decisions on the funding streams when they come available.
So it's dust on the boots.
Absolutely.
All right, so that's a really interesting, conclusion. Greg, what about for you and Sadie?
I won't talk about funding because that's a given. I think performance-based policy rather than politics-based policy is the biggest shift. And I think the example that we've done with the hard work in the SEQ waste strategy and the strategic plan and the alignment of funding around that has really come out of a process that has us all committed and the state committed, although everybody at the table, it's so rare, we keep reminding people this is about performance, not your politics ahead of the next election, including for us as councils. That's a really important transformation because the dollars are getting scarce. You need to get the bang for every buck. So that's one. For me, the other that leads to that is, and I hark back to a dear Indigenous friend in South Australia when I was in the up near Woomera with him, who said, "You walk softly, listen well, be patient. The country takes a long time to talk." And that is the experience of life, that balance is important. And there is incredible, it is damned hard work if you're trying to force people to move because of a policy setting that's political, rather than something that they are passionate about because it connects to their life. And you'll spend a lot less money for a lot more bang for buck. So that big one is the listening. And a simple example, and this comes up in all of our, the balance of the voice in planning decisions for local councils to be able to consider things like heat loads, performance of corridors, performance of changing climate and how they want their community to work in the formation of planning schemes rather than the strict confines of an SEQ regional plan or the planning regulation, locking councils out of having that level of flexibility to work with their community about that design.
Yeah. Marta, bit of support for you there. For Greg, Marta, what would be the best thing to come out of this box to support your council and councils like yours, Barkie, for example, as they manage climate change, climate risk, climate opportunity?
Yeah, well, the opportunities are probably the important focus. All the previous speakers have hit on the right thing. To put a little different tilt on it, we are remote. I keep saying we're remote. We're different. Look at me. We're different.
I reckon
you're just like because not because we want to be. It's because we are. And it's similar to some of the problems that Mayor Ross is facing up there. So understanding is one of them. I mean, some of these projects that we've got going in the Central West, and the one in our shire in particular, there's money there to incentivise regional manufacturing and supporting innovation and all those things like the wool mill. The policy framework has absolutely no relevance to anything that we're applying for. The grant funding, for example, Made in Queensland, great name, great outcome, fair bit of money there, but by the time we tick all the boxes to get any grant out of the Made in Queensland fund, we don't need the funding. You've got to be Gina Reinhart to get the grant. So it's been written by someone who has absolutely no understanding of A, remote areas, B, business, corporate or private or whatever. The social imperatives are all around that. I mean, we've got to keep people out there. We've got to get young people, keep them there, incentivise them to stay there. We've got to have these innovative projects to keep people there. Our old people are just starting to retire out there and loving it. You've got to keep them happy. You've got to keep them alive. But it's all around understanding of the remote condition, if you like. But it involves money. Not so much, but money.
Yeah, Tim, I was just going to say, and I meant to say it earlier, I think one of the other key elements is about place-based planning. You know, like when the plans are, which I think is where Marta's going, like the plans are holistically, you know, genuinely well-intended, But once you delve into the devil and the detail inside, if you look at the Queensland Jobs and Energy Plan, for example, it's very, very focused, obviously, on energy. So in relevance to our region, 30% of the coal is energy driven. Well, where's the plan and the implementation and the, you know, real focus on the other 70%? It doesn't exist. There's actually currently, as we sit here today, there's nothing in existence. And I've got communities, like every other council in this room, in particular in terms of in the climate change context and decarb conversation, that are on life support now because there's mines that have come to end of mine life, the companies are exiting, and the community is being left to, well, see you later, after 38 years. That's just not acceptable. So that's the point of difference. And I think it comes back to, holistically, it comes back to the place-based, so it's not a one-size-fits-all. So when people are making decisions and big environmental decisions and they haven't actually been inside, into Douglas, on the ground in Douglas, it's exactly the same as making decisions relevant to our region and not coming in. You have to go and visit your friends and your relatives and to understand what they're really like, right? You don't get to know them over the phone.
You make a good point, and as always, you make it very well. I should just mention that your deputy mayor is on the drum tonight.
Yes, Councillor Vivi's on the drum. I'm at a climate resilience forum, and Councillor Vivi's on the drum.
Yeah,
so
been invited
we're out and
to,
about today.
To Q&A, she was fantastic last time she was on there. So if you're staying for a drink, you'll be able to watch it later on iView.
It's about banking, not climate change. It's about banking.
But I'll bet you she'll. All right, so we've got about 15 minutes to go.
So before there's what is most frustrating in this conversation?
The MC.
I love the MC. I love the bookends. I listen to that. Anyone who has driven through Middle America, Central US, there is a total case study of total loss of community that has happened three times in the last 100 years through massive whole states of the US. And for whatever reason, governments around the world, perhaps even ours, don't seem to have the capacity to look at that and learn from the realization that when you allow your steel industry to move offshore, suddenly whole towns close down. When your automotive world gets moved to manufacturing out of China, you lose whole communities, and you have councils that go bankrupt. You know, I've been involved when Detroit went bankrupt. You know, there's an alarm bell there. There's an inevitable cliff, even without talking about climate resilience, just economic resilience. You cannot talk about climate resilience without economic resilience, but I'm pleased today to hear the social fabric being talked about. Last night, by good fortune, I got invited to a Bond University conversation with the Planning Institute. Any planners in the room?
Oh, yes.
It's great to see.
Any planners not in the room?
One of the most interesting pieces of conversation happened in the Q&A at the end of what I haven't heard in the last 2.5 hours from any speaker to all these young graduates is the conversation about how you plan for human existence so we can deal with youth crime by the design of community back into the way we deal with habitation. So focused on putting people in houses, we've forgotten about the function of community. Tell me how you're going to do that with your planners.
Yeah, all right. Emma is desperate for me to get to you for questions, so I'm going to come back and ask my question at the end of each of you about re-funded QCRC program and what we might focus on. But could I please have a hand up for a question from the floor for any of our five brave mayors that are up here on the stage. Over at the back there, thank you very much, Amanda.
It's a big room.
Thank you. Good afternoon.
G'day everyone, my name's Donovan Burton.
And you mentioned that the conversation with the drummers about banking and there's no connection with climate change. I actually think that's the missing element. And I'm interested to know how many of local governments have actually been talking to the banks to see what they're doing around climate change, because I work with banks, so I'm interested in, there's a big gap there.
Yeah, Council, my Deputy Mayor has been invited on, and it's just one of the subject matters tonight. What I actually said was she's talking about banking closures and I'm talking about climate change. And we definitely have been leaning in, because we've, like, I think nearly every, I'm not sure every mayor on the stage, but I heard Marto just say that in regional and rural Australia, like what we're seeing, the big banks walk, just close up, and the view that we'll be putting forward tonight is the fact that the reasoning for that is, in our instance, is foot traffic. And I feel that it's extraordinarily offensive, because for the last two decades, they have had strategies to encourage people to use the ATM, was the first one. Part two of that strategy was then to move to internet banking, and part 2A is internet apps, which we all use, and I couldn't survive without mine today. But to come back to regional Australia and rural Australia with an exit reason of there's not enough foot traffic there, I think we should be really, really pushing back around an intention of setting regional Australia up to fail in the banking area. So,
have you noticed how much smaller their record profits haven't been since they they did that? Do you have another question from? Sorry, Greg, go on, mate.
That's an important one.
Greg,
I don't know whether this. But I think we've all been through, you know, we've been through some of the banks withdrawing branches, and we've had the conversation, and we've got some that have stayed. But we've also had the next tier banks who've been really proactive. And what's great about them is they're back to the original model of banks, where they're community banks, so everyone's a shareholder, the community is taking ownership. I find that exciting. But I also have good conversation with banks, probably not the big four. I have a number of banks, probably from my business background, who I know for a long time, like since 93 at least, have been having conversations. They've been focused on investing in the industries that will be sustainable and the businesses that are more than 50-year horizon. The problem we have in Australia is that most of us get driven by the share market to think in three-year cycles like America. If you talk to Asian banks, if you can't plan 30 years ahead, they're not interested in talking. And so that's the Asian banks, the Singaporean banks, the Taiwanese banks particularly, I love that conversation. They have an appetite to invest where there's a focus on creating a transformation that'll grow in 10 years' time, not give them a payback tomorrow. That's where we need to take our journey. I'm really sad that many of our Australian banks lack that vision.
That is a very interesting point. Is the old Roman saying, a society grows great when men plant trees in whose shade they will not sit? And
that's
version of
that's
that,
correct, yes.
Really?
Yeah. Yes.
Do we have another question? Amanda, just put someone's arm up behind their back until they've got one. Even if it is, when will you stop putting my arm up behind my back, please? We must have another question, or I'll just keep going. Oh, over the side here. Getting it easy here, Em.
Hello.
Good afternoon.
Hello. I wanted to ask a question. I'm Sarah from the Gold Coast City Council. I wanted to ask a question regarding some of the aspects that have been brought up today, such as regenerative agriculture and I guess changes in culture as a whole. How you referred in passing before about how America could be a case study, a good case study. Do you think that the council should, or ideally could, play a part in supporting local culture changes that would then, as a knock-on effect, have a positive climate change effects? So whether that be in local banking, in regenerative agriculture, in use of, as you're saying, the size of land to, for individual houses, allotments. What role do you think a council could put forward to its people to induce that culture change locally?
Great question. And I think we're already doing a number of them. Whilst at a policy level, it took us a while to get an alignment that we had comfort with politically. We've had some really great programs rolling, like a Million Trees program is a great example. What we have out of that is community programs, where, in fact, there's a group called the Wild Mountain Group. Look them up. They actually, before COVID, back now again, they used to have people who'd book a holiday to come and help clear weed species and plant trees to revegetate a forest. That was their holiday. And so it's creating these cultures of people. Everybody cares. They just don't know how to convert caring to action. We have the opportunity to facilitate a conversation to get aligned action that creates impact. That's the role we have as local councils that state governments and federal governments can never comprehend and never achieve. That's the power of local government. That's why I love being in it. And it's, I could do it in business at a level, and in local areas we have seen it in the past. So that's one example. The other examples is the programs you support create a conversation and a language. So with small budget, you can create big conversation because you engage people who take the... I hate social media most of the time, but boy, it's great when it's got a good news story to spread. And it can be really empowering to link that story and create... I see it as these pinpoints of light that come together to create a spotlight that shines to space. That's what you can do when you get that empowered. And so there's a whole heap of things we can do, I think, but we also lead by example. You know, I've had the privilege, and I didn't understand it as a 13-year-old child, which was just a little bit more than 50 years ago, when my father had me helping fencing into cell grazing. But 20 years later, I got to go and visit New Mexico and see the impact of cell grazing converting desert back into high-performing land, which is the first of my knowledge-based journey into regenerative land management. And it's been a passion ever since. So I share that story, and I take people on that journey, and that's the power of one that we should never underestimate. A conversation that lays an evidence path for people to believe in possibility. So in 2020, we started a journey of regenerative land management with anyone who wanted to come. And we had to put a cap on bookings because of a little thing that was going on in 2020-21, which I won't talk about by name. But DAF got so excited by our program, they paid for people to come from other parts of Queensland to participate in our program. And it started this collaboration conversation that's still going today. And it'll build momentum over the fence to the neighbour. Your carrying capacity is better than mine through this drought. How come? That's how people react. They want to see something better and aspire to it.
Greg, thank you for that. Something you said then just reminded me of something that Nina said this morning, and it's rattled around in my head ever since. Now, to be fair, there's quite a bit more vacant real estate in my head than there clearly is in yours. You're one of the most remarkable thinkers I've ever met in my work. But Nina said that risk is a feeling, and I've been pondering that and reflecting on that through the day, and what you were talking about that fear and that concern, but turning it into action, has kind of come back to that for me. So it's nice to have, in a sense, that circle closed. I don't have an answer to it yet, but that's your job. But now we need to wrap because we're going to afternoon tea, and then we're getting into groups where there's no performative component to it. Okay, no one will be expected to speak. There is karaoke, but there no one.
We got the microphone.
Hadn't finished yet with interpretive dance. But we won't be having spokespeople or anything like that. But can I ask each of you, and to answer very briefly, if you would, please. Should the queue
CRC program receive further funding, and obviously we hope, given what it's delivering, that, that it does. Just one thing perhaps from you, Marto, please. What is a focus it could have going forward?
Oh, as we've all intimated, from my perspective, we need access to the results of ongoing funding for that. For all those things, you know, the regenerative thing, we're broadacre, we're not intensive like Greg here. And we've got a couple of bad apples, I suppose, but they just drop off the tree and get shoved off to one side. It's the human condition. But by and large, we're into regenerative. We've got to. We want to leave our land in better form than when we found the thing. You know, the water off the woolen mill will go into growing jute, which will make housing blocks. All those sorts of things is on the thing. So it must go forward. We must, in the remote areas, my fellow mayor up here, all of us really, we need better access to the and an understanding that there are different strokes for different folks.
Sure. Very nice. Thank you for that. Greg, one thing for a focus.
strengthening the capacity to lift the planning conversation, the analysis, and understanding and analysis creates good decisions. We all have different variability in our understanding and analysis at the moment. That takes a lot of work to build. We've got a global model, but there are some really great examples. How do we tap into it?
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Michael.
Yeah, I agree with those, but also things around waste management. Yeah, whether it be landfill, whether it be infrastructure, renewables, that whole waste area needs to be looked at.
Some, for some councils, and going back again to you, Greg, that's, for some councils that's been an opportunity. Geography, I think, plays a lot to do with that, but of course for other, it's an absolute devil, isn't it? And for you, one focus area for a refunded QCRC program.
Look, I think that this fits really nicely into the transformational framework, and what we know is the federal government have adopted principles for a transition authority. Yep. On the federal platform, the national cabinet has all bought into those national principles. So a national transition authority, bring it to the Queensland transition into government, call it whatever you want, but it's an actual funded. I think there's really a lane in this increased funding, Minister Scanlon, for this program that will allow this to drive through, and it's in the form of a transformation authority that will cover or fund all elements of the topic.
Yep. Ross, a final thought from you on one focus you'd like to see a refunded QCRC program take.
Yeah, just echoing the sentiments of our mayors up here is, all our councils have strategies and plans, and it's just a continuation of implementing and resourcing those plans. But if I could appeal, as a local government family, we have 77 shires in Queensland, over 500, I think, nationally. And each of our shires within those 77 shires have First Nations, a community within the community as well. And their contribution, please don't undervalue their contribution in terms of global warming and climate change. Have a relationship, have a friendship with our First Nations community, because we believe that we can help as well with many of the challenges that we're here today.
Please thank. Please thank Mayors Ross Andrews and Baker, Michael Kerr, Greg Christensen, and Andrew Martin. Please say thank you.